Governor Diwa Ginigundo. We also have Assistant Governor Ramona Santiago. And we also have Deputy General Counsel Vincent Bolivar. For PDIC, we have Attorney Maria Antoinette Bolivar, General Counsel. For BAP, Bankers Association of the Philippines, we have Mr. Cesar Virtuzio, the Managing Director. For we also have Mr. Arnel Almaden, the Associate Director. And for the Rural Bankers Association of the Philippines, we have Mr. Antonio Pastia, the President. We also have Attorney Ruben Purisima, the Legal Counsel. For the Chamber of Thrift Banks, we have Ms. Suzanne Felix, Executive Director. For we also have consultant, Mr. Benjamin Yambao. For the Land Bank of the Philippines, we have the OIC, the EVP, Ms. Cecilia Borromeo. We also have Attorney Noel Marquez. And for the AMLAC, we also have Attorney Vincent Salido. For the SEC, we have Attorney Ella Xavier Padilla. That's all, Mr. Senator.
Attorney Salido, Vincent talaga yan. O nagkamali kami? First time I come across that name. Chair would like to acknowledge the presence of Senator Drilon, one of the authors of the bills that we'll be taking up this morning. Moving forward, Chair would like to acknowledge the presence of Deputy Governor Spinelli as well. Good morning, sir. Moving forward, let's take up item one in the agenda, amendment to the new Central Bank Act, namely Senate Bill number 16, authored by Senator Drilon, 859, authored by Senator Rector, and 1027, authored by the chairperson. May I ask Senator Drilon if he intends to make some opening statements with respect to his bill?
No opening statement, Your Honor.
Thank you, Senator Drilon. Governor Tatanka, would you like to make a presentation?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Honorable Senator, Francis Escudero, the Chairman of the Senate Committee on Banks, Financial Institutions, and Currencies, Senate President Pro Tempore Franklin Drilon, Senator Rin Gatchalian, colleagues in government, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Mr. Chairman, first of all, on behalf of the Monetary Board, I thank the committee for holding this hearing and for this opportunity to provide our position and express our support to the legislative proposals amending the BSP Charter or Republic Act number 7653 and the existing bank deposit secrecy laws, namely Republic Act numbers 1405 and 4262. The proposed measures seek to strengthen the BSP in the performance of its mandate entrusted to it by the 1987 Constitution. The BSP wishes to convey its unwavering support to the passage of Senate Bill number 1027, sponsored by the Honorable Chairman Senator Escudero, that seeks to amend the BSP Charter by giving the BSP greater operational flexibility and more financial resources to better serve our people and our country. In order to keep pace with the demands of changing economic environment, the BSP needs to be more effective and dynamic as a central monetary authority. Mr. Chairman, Republic Act 7653, or the Central Bank Charter, has enabled the BSP to maintain monetary stability, safeguard our financial system, and strengthen our economy amidst various threats over the last two decades. However, since the restructuring of the central bank into the BSP in 1993, the environment we operate in has changed. For one, we experienced two financial crises, the Asian financial crisis and the global financial crisis, over the last 23 years. Our economy has grown by 8 times in nominal terms, The resources of the banking system have expanded by a multiple of 12, and the BSP's own balance sheet has also grown by a factor of 8. In addition, the financial and goods markets have become more interconnected globally. Moreover, technology has evolved significantly, resulting in the financial consumer demanding new ways of delivery of financial services, which requires new supervisory skills and improved consumer protection standards. Indeed, the developments in the last two decades have caused an increase in the complexity and scale of the responsibilities of the BSP. There is clearly a strong need to revisit Republic Act No. 7653. The BSP's proposals fall under three distinct but interrelated categories: monetary stability, financial stability, and corporate viability. Sir Chairman, allow me to quickly run through the main proposed amendments. Monetary stability will preserve the purchasing power of the peso and its convertibility to goods and assets, both here and abroad. In this respect, we seek the restoration of the central bank's authority to issue its own securities consistent with the practice of monetary authorities worldwide. We aim for the removal of the outdated constraints in the growth of monetary aggregates and credit as the guiding principles and operational strictures of monetary policy implementation. We ask for the reinstatement of the central bank's authority to obtain information from the non-bank private sector consistent with the practice of monetary authorities all over the world. The Senate can be assured that the BSP is sensitive to local practices. Hence, we remain committed to the protection of deposit secrecy in the implementation of this amendment. With respect to financial stability, we wish to enhance the ability of our people with excess funds to save with confidence, while those in need of funding can borrow at a cost commensurate to their risk and income-generating profile. The Banco Central puts forward the formal recognition of financial stability in the central bank's statutory mandate, as well as formally providing oversight over the payment and settlement system of the country. It should be noted that both are common hallmarks of modern central banks. We also seek legal protection for BSP officials and staff in the performance of official duties similar to that provided to officers and employees of the Philippine Deposit Insurance Corporation. We also request for the enhancement of the BSP supervisory authority by expanding the list of entities it supervises and to expand its authority over the banking system. Lastly, we present to the Senate the case for ensuring the corporate viability of the BSP. We seek for an increase in its capitalization by 150 billion pesos. The economy has expanded, the financial system we supervise has grown many times over, while the BSP's capitalization has remained constant in the last 23 years. To better manage the risks it faces in its operations, we seek the authority to establish adequate loss allowances and create reserve buffers. In recognition that the funds deployed by the BSP are public in nature, we ask for the restoration of our tax-exempt status and the treatment of unsecured BSP claims as preferred credit similar to that enjoyed by the Philippine Deposit Insurance Corporation. Mr. Chairman, we wish to convey to you that the BSP, once strengthened, can be even more responsive in meeting the challenges to the economy and the financial system over the coming decades. An even stronger BSP can help more efficiently create the space for the Philippine economy to continue flourishing despite the many challenges it will face. On a separate vein, we also seek your support for the proposed amendments to the Bank Deposit Secrecy Act, but this is item number 2 in the agenda for today's hearing, a number of unsafe and unsound banking practices involve deposit account transactions. Those practices can be established and proceeded against only if the bank supervisor is granted the authority to look into those accounts. As a safeguard, the inquiry into the deposit account shall only be made in the course of bank examination. I will end here, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your strong support. And once again, good morning.
Thank you, Mr. Governor. Before we proceed, Chair would like to direct the committee secretary to communicate with the Department of Finance and DBM with respect to the additional capitalization requirement of the central bank, and to get their comments only on that point. Senator Dillon, would you like to make an intervention?
Well, just initially on the comment made by the chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to raise a question just on that point, and we go to other points later. The proposal requires an automatic appropriation in case there is need to further increase the capital. From the way I understand it, Mr. Governor, amendment first will increase the capitalization from 50 to 200 billion. Fine. And then the next amendment in that regard will require the payment in cash and or government securities upon the effectivity of this act. So the first question I raised to the chair and also to the governor is, does this mean that this we automatically appropriate today, I mean, assuming that we pass it today? The second point is, after 5 years, there is supposed to be a review now. And if there is, again, a need for new capital infusion, the proposal is to automatically appropriate it. I have my doubts about the second one. So can we have your comments on this? Initially, Mr. Chairman, may I ask the Banco Central?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our proposal is for the capitalization, the additional capitalization of 150 billion to be given to the BSP in one lump sum. Now, the form by which this amount is going to be given can be discussed. It is possible that the additional capitalization can be given in the form of government securities.
My question, I guess, is, Mr. Chairman, this is an automatic appropriation that would require, certification by the National Treasury? Is this an appropriation that would require a special certification from the National Treasury? Or this is an obligation which must be defined in the, or must be included in the General Appropriations Act? I'm just asking the question. I have no answer.
We're proposing that it be a special appropriation, Mr. Chairman.
That it be special appropriation. So, Mr. Chair, I addressed it to our technical committee. Would a special appropriation require a certification from the National Treasury? Because if we just say increase in capitalization, the actual payment is an appropriation, right? Now, so you're saying it must be automatically appropriated, therefore it is in effect saying we are appropriating from the national funds the sum of whatever is necessary in order to pay for the subscription. That's the first question I raised to the chair and also to the governor. The second point is future subscription also is automatically appropriated. That's what is provided for here.
Our proposal, Mr. Chairman, is for a review to be conducted every 5 years. And this review will be conducted by the Secretary of Finance, Secretary of Budget and Management, and the Monetary Board to establish whether or not the BSP would need additional capital at that time. Now, our proposal again is if there's indeed a demonstration or reason that additional capital will be needed by the BSP, then we will also ask for the automatic appropriation to cover that particular amount. Now, let me just explain, Mr. Chairman. Another part of the amendments calls for the establishment of a reserve fund. Okay, so the reserve fund would be put up from the profits that the BSP may earn in the future. Now, in case there's a need for recapitalization, then the amount that would be required would first be taken from the reserve fund. Any amount that will be, if the amount in the reserve, available in the reserve fund is deficient, then our proposal is for the government to appropriate the balance.
First, we do not question the need for a mechanism wherein the additional capital would be necessary. And a recommendation from the Secretary of Finance jointly with the Monetary Board, etc., that is not, you know, I accept that as a valid proposition. my question, I guess, revolves around the need for an appropriation in the General Appropriations Act as against the proposal to automatically appropriate it from the general funds. I have my doubts about that, but I'm willing to be corrected by a technical study on this, including the matter of the whatever capital is needed be first drawn from the supposed fund where profits will be deposited. I'm just concerned about questions that can be raised on the automatic appropriation to increase the capitalization.
Point well taken, Senator Drilon, and we will look into it. I guess the concern, Mr. Governor, is if it is automatically appropriated, it will be considered an off-budget item, and it won't even have to pass through Congress anymore, and won't even pass through the scrutiny of Congress anymore. On your end, I understand the concern too. Matagal na kayong pinangakuan ng pondo, sinabi isa, dalawa, tatlong taon, hindi naman nabigay ng gobyerno sa loob ng isa, dalawa, tatlong taon. So you also want to be sure that indeed any increase in capitalization will be fully subscribed by government at a relatively more predictable time frame. We will address both concerns, Senator Drilon, Governor Tatanka, and we'll find common ground. If I can proceed, unless Senator Drilon has an additional point on this matter.
None on that point, Mr. Chair.
May I ask some of our invited guests, particularly from the Bankers Association of the Philippines, who can I address? If you have any comments or if you've seen already the various versions of the amendments to the Central Bank Act? Yes, Mr. Vertusio.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, honorable members of the Senate, Governor Titanco, and our colleagues from the Central Bank. As a general statement, and let me just start with, if I may, that the Bankers Association expresses its support of the BSP's policy on bank secrecy of deposits. And there, recommendations as well.
On the Central Bank Act amendment, sir.
On the amendment, if I may have a couple of general statements.
Please, sir.
Please. We plead for, we agree in general that, fully agree in general that the bank, Central Bank, Republic Act 7653 should be amended. And we plead for reasonableness in the promulgation of the amendment thereof, particularly as they relate to regulation and to the proposed virtual immunity that the proposed amendment would provide to the regulators. We also would like to suggest that such amendments promote check and balance between the positions of the banking industries and the regulators. And we would be happy to suggest specific proposals as and when we go into technical committee meetings, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
That would be more than welcome, sir. Thank you very much. But do you have a formal position paper that you will be submitting today or at some future time?
Oh, we will be submitting a position paper at some future time soon, Mr. Chairman.
We will come up with a matrix comparing the various bills on this subject matter so that you can compare. As best as we can, we will reconcile all three versions of the bill, and I guess that's where your position paper can come in.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, we will do that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Can I now get the statements, if any, of Mr. Pasha from the Rural Bankers Association of the Philippines, sir? Again, on item number one. Yung amendments po sa Central Bank or BSP Charter?
Yeah, wala po kaming objection doon po.
Same, sir. We will be furnishing with a matrix of the three bills. Kindly refer to it when you submit your comments. We prefer, of course, a written position paper, even a one-pager, saying you're in favor of it or you're not or what your concerns are.
Sige po.
Thank you very much. Ms. Felix or Mr. Yambao? From the Chamber of Thrift Banks.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Felix, good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. Senator Drilon, Senator Escudero, Senator Gachalian, Governor Tatanco, Deputy Governors Espinilla and Ginigundo. Thank you for inviting us to this hearing. With regard to the proposed amendments to the new Central Bank Act, the Chamber of Thrift Banks affirms its support for the bills in general, and we agree with most of the provisions of the proposed measures. CTB appreciates that there is a need to respond to contemporary challenges by amending the present BSP Charter in order that the BSP remains effective in its conduct of monetary policy and supervision of financial institutions and enable it to build a robust system and ensure the financial stability of the banking system. We submitted something late Friday, Mr. Chairman. We in matrix form. We just had, cited just one suggestion there, with regard to the authority to approve the transfer of shares, because the existing is the threshold is 20%, and the proposed amendment is to lower it to 10%. There's a suggestion from some of our members to maintain the 20% threshold. But other than that, we are supportive of the measures, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Noted, ma'am, and thank you very much. Senator Dillon?
Still in general or?
In general. In general, still on item number one.
Other than item number one?
Item number one pa rin po tayo. Sa amendments.
All right. Yes, there are a few questions I would like to raise, some clarificatory. For example, on Section 2 of the bill, is it Section 2? All right. Bill seeks to expand the coverage of the regulatory powers of the BSP to money service businesses, credit granting businesses, and payment system of operators. This would include money, how do you call it, money changers? Can we have that's for the record?
That would include money changers.
Yeah. We have no problems with that. Now, credit granting facilities, who are payment system operators?
Like the Megalink.
Sorry?
The RTGS, the real-time gross settlement system. The electronic money issuers.
Would you have supervision presently over companies like Philrem?
It's not clear in the law, Mr. Chairman. The regulation, in as far as entities like that, are concerned, the BSP only requires registration.
Mm-hmm.
But the BSP does not have supervisory power.
Mm-hmm. Meaning they're not subject to regular annual examination?
They are not, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator, they're not.
Philrem, companies like Philrem. And would an amendment such as this cut transactions like RCBC transaction, which was recently the subject of so much public debate?
Will there be a mechanism to try and prevent or catch transactions of that nature, Mr. Chairman?
For the record, which government entity is now supervising money service businesses, or is it SEC?
I think there's no other entity at this point, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator. The BSP actually is looking into the money service businesses only in as far as their compliance with the anti-money laundering law provisions is concerned.
And you are looking into that as part of the Anti-Money Laundering Council?
Well, there's an existing regulation, Mr. Chairman, that this should be registered with the BSP.
Mm-hmm.
And the basis for that is the AMLA, so that we can track the creation and the establishment of money service businesses.
Do you have supervision over such entities, over money changers, for example, to the same extent that you have supervision over the banks?
We do not, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator. And that is precisely what we want to address.
So who supervises them at this point? Voila, they just get registered and then they just do their own thing?
They register with the local government unit. There is no regulatory authority that oversees the operations of these firms.
I would fully endorse such supervision by the Banco Central of these entities, Mr. Chairman. I also wish to highlight that I would support the provision on the liability of the BSP personnel, meaning that you should enjoy that presumption of the regularity of performance of functions, and you should not be civilly liable for acts done in the performance of your duties unless there is a clear showing of bad faith or gross or ignorance or malice. This is actually the jurisprudence on public officers. I see the need for that extension of protection to our banco, to our Banco Central personnel. Now, this one is a little touchy. This is a matter of the inquiry into the exemption of the CB of the Banco Central on coverage of bank secrecy and allowing them to inquire into bank deposits in the course of the examination. Can you amplify on this, Mr. Governor?
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator, the idea is for the BSP to be able to look into the accounts or into bank accounts during the course of an examination. If there are conditions, and the most important condition is if there is a reasonable ground to believe that fraud, unlawful activity or irregularity has been committed or is being committed in the bank. And this would basically mean that it is not, you know, an umbrella authority for the BSP examination team to look into the bank accounts of individuals or corporations which are clients of the bank.
And these are, this is an authority to look in the accounts in the course of the annual examination, or can it be done anytime?
It can be done anytime, Mr. Chairman, for as long as there's an authority from the Monetary Board for a special examination to be conducted by the Supervision and Examination Sector of the BSP. And as you may be aware, the required number of votes to have a special examination authorized is 5. So it's a super majority as far
which
as
is what, 2/3?
5 out of 7, Mr. Chairman.
5 out of 7. What's that?
More than 2/3.
More than 2/3. Not 3/4 though. Anyway, whatever. Why was it a peculiar?
No, because for other decisions, Mr. Chairman, simple majority would be sufficient. In this case, there's a higher bar.
Higher than
ordinary decisions of the board.
So 5 out. Now, are we saying, therefore, that the judgment of the court, which is what is now the standard under the bank secrecy law or under the Anti-Money Laundering Act, is now will now be exercised by the Monetary Board? I guess that's the bottom line issue. In other words, presently, as the present state of things, you get an authority of the court. In this particular case, that authority, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Governor, that authority is now exercised by the Monetary Board through a super majority vote, or 5 out of 7 votes. Is that the interpretation? That instead of the court exercising that authority, the Monetary Board will be the one to exercise that authority. And whether or not it's related to any particular suspicious transaction.
That would be the meaning, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator. But it is an authority that can be exercised by the BSP under very clear conditions. If the committee may recall, this authority of the old central bank was actually in the old BSP charter, RA 265, and then when the central bank was restructured in 1993 and became the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, this was removed. So what we're asking, Mr. Chairman, is for this authority simply to be restored as part of the authority of the central bank, of the BSP.
Yes, that is the historical fact. But after that, there was the Anti-Money Laundering Act, which now required judicial determination of exemptions, in effect, from the bank secrecy deposit law. So this is what I'm pointing out to the committee, Mr. Chairman, that the discretion determination that is now lodged with the courts in the examination of bank accounts and within the limitations that are imposed by the present law for the courts to exercise the discretion is now transferred to the Monetary Board, and such limitation would appear not to be applicable. I mean, just to set the parameters of what the central bank would like to do or would like to have, subject, of course, to our decision as a committee, whether such an unbridled authority should be located in a non-judicial entity.
Can I just make a comment, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, please.
Mr. Senator. In the case of the AMLA, the way I understand it is that the authority to look into bank accounts actually happens after the violation has already been committed.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, there is a predicate crime that has been identified, an investigation has been conducted, and then the AMLA goes to the court for a look-through the accounts, approval of a look-through the accounts. Now, in the case of our proposal, this is really meant to be preventive. So earlier, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator, you asked whether the case, the famous case, could have been prevented. I think there would have been a better chance of detecting that at an early stage if the BSP had two things. One, supervisory powers over money service businesses, and two, the authority to look into the accounts. That's number one. Number two is that if it's the BSP that will conduct or that will be given this authority, the process will be quicker, more timely, and expeditious, Mr. Mm-hmm. Chairman. So it's preventive and more expeditious action.
Yeah. Will the prohibition against publication of such findings be also applicable, as it is applicable in the same secrecy of bank deposits law?
It will be applicable, Mr. Chairman. Mr.
Meaning
Senator.
You cannot publish
you
the
cannot
results?
Publish. In fact, we are proposing that there will be a confidentiality clause and appropriate sanctions provided for in the law for any breach of this rule.
Separate. Separate from the immunity provisions provided for in the amendments.
Yes. We would like to have this provision also in the proposed amendment to allow the BSP to require private entities to submit information to the BSP. And that can be taken up maybe later, as the chair would wish.
Magsisegue din ho siguro tayo doon, Governor, with the permission of Senator John. But can I ask, ilan pa ho bang bansa sa mundo o karamihan ba may secrecy of bank deposits pa? Meaning, to your knowledge?
I think there are only two at this point, Mr. Chairman, and we're one of them.
Two countries? The other one is?
Lebanon.
Lebanon?
Which is,
so, wala nang ibang bansa sa mundo ang may secrecy of bank deposits?
Siguro yung North Korea.
May bangko ho ba dun?
Meron ho, mayroong bangko dun. Pero
but
nasa Macau.
May I ask again, I think this will be one of the stickier issues sa amendments. May I ask the banking sector, either from the BAP, the RBAP, or the CTB, may epekto pa ba talaga yung secrecy na pag ni-repeal namin, worst case, i-repeal namin ang secrecy of bank deposits, magkaka-bankrupt po ba? Mag-aalisan po ba ang mga tao sa banko dahil baka malaman na yung account nila? Ganun po ba yan? Is there such a concern? Because if the governor is correct that only two countries in the world have it, and it seems that banks in other countries and jurisdictions have thus far survived, even after it was lifted, or probably nung simula pa, nung una ba ko, governor, meron sila?
Yes, these countries had secrecy of bank deposits.
Most countries in the world had secrecy of bank deposits.
Many had in the past.
Tapos inalis din nila.
Yeah, the secrecy law was.
To your knowledge, was there any adverse effects to the banking sector when it was lifted in those jurisdictions? I'm sure with some meron, with others wala. But do you have data on this?
Well, we conducted a survey of jurisdictions which have bank secrecy laws, but provide exemption to bank regulators, supervisors. But in answer to your question, Mr. Chairman, we're not aware of any adverse impact like in the form of bank runs in those countries. But we can double check that.
Kindly give us that data, sir.
Yes.
I'm sorry for interrupting,
but,
Mr. Verg.
You're right, Mr. Chairman, because if only two or three countries in the world have bank secrecy laws, then the concern really is not with respect to possible bank runs, because these laws have been lifted in other countries. The concern really is for the possibility of dirty money or laundered money ending up in those jurisdictions that have very strict bank secrecy laws.
Thank you, Mr. Governor. Mr. Vertusio, sorry for the interruption. Please proceed, sir.
Mr. Chairman, just to reiterate, the Bankers Association support the position of the Banco Central in the proposed measures regarding the bank secrecy law. And I would like to echo the governor's comment about, you know, and I think Mr. President Pro Tempore, Senator Drillon also discussed the history. I think in the last decade, particularly the last 10 years, there's been so many new developments in the financial world, good governance and so on and so forth. And the Philippines would like to be a respected member of that financial world. So there is a persuasive argument that we should not be the pariah, the one of the two countries left. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Governor, Switzerland will remove all their secrecy by 2017, or is it 2018? So, and again, to echo the governor's comments, we know we don't expect any reactions like bank runs. It is more really like being a good world citizen in the financial world. Thank you.
Let me go a step further, sir. Insofar as the BAP is concerned, because so far the bills filed seek to amend the bank secrecy law by relaxing it, opening it up insofar as public officials are concerned, insofar as this provision in the charter is concerned, authorizing the BSP to look into certain accounts. So if at all you won't have any, the BAP will not have any objections if we altogether repeal RA 1405. No qualms and concerns whatsoever.
We would support the positions of the Bank Central on this measure, Your Honor.
May I ask you, Mr. Governor, would you be, inaamendahan lang natin, nire-relax natin eh, just out of curiosity, would you support, would the Banco Central officially support a repeal of RA 1405?
Our main concern, Mr. Chairman, with respect to the bank secrecy law is in terms of being able to ensure that regulations, existing regulations, are being complied with. That's number one. And number two, to provide some form of deterrent for possible fraud, unlawful activity, or irregularity, and for this to be taken, any course or action can be taken expeditiously.
Yes, Senator Gachalian.
Just a very quick elementary question, Mr.
Please
Chair.
Please continue, sir.
Alam naman ho natin, karamihan sa mga negosyante ho natin, ang kinakatakutan ho nila yung KFR, no? Kidnap for ransom, na marami sa mga investigasyon lumalabas po na may mga leak nung kanilang bank accounts. Minsan ho, kung magpapasweldo ho sila ay nalalaman, no, kung kailan po magpapasweldo. Ano pong assurance and mechanism ang pwede nating ibigay sa ating mga negosyante para hindi naman ho sila kabahan at magamit to sa mga KFR at ganito mga aktibidad?
Mr. Governor, sasagutin ko yun kung ayaw niyo sagutin. O gusto niyo mag-imbita tayo, imbitahin natin si Bato dito.
Kahit po ngayong meron ang bank secrecy, meron din KFR. No? Now, as I mentioned earlier, the authority to look into bank accounts will be allowed under certain conditions. So this will be quite specific in the law. And in addition to that, there'll be sanctions in case there's a breach of confidentiality. And thirdly, I think we should not forget that banks are, by their nature, discreet. Now, if you ask me how we can guarantee, that's difficult to answer because it could be the work of a bank employee. And you know, we don't police to that level, down to that level, Mr. Chairman.
May I proceed with the other guests? Mr. Pasha, sir, on this point, any concerns with respect to the relaxation of the bank secrecy laws on the part of the Rural Bankers Association?
Siguro po on the part of the rural bankers, wala naman ho siguro ang problema kami dyan ho.
Wala naman po nakikidnap na...
Wala ho, maliliit naman ho yung mga nasa countryside po natin.
Sa Chamber of Thrift Banks, ma'am?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, we expressed our support actually for that provision granting the BSP that authority because it's based on specific transactions. That is, I think, the assurance here and not necessarily... And it can only be done in the course of an examination, only when they find something to be fraudulent. I think that is that was the assurance given also to us, the banks. They will look at specific transactions in the course of an examination. So it's not really looking at depositors per se. So we support that particular.
Not on this, not on item number one. Tama po?
Just to clarify, we are talking here about the authority of the central bank,
yes,
vis-a-vis the bank secrecy.
Yes.
Not the bank secrecy
not
of loans.
Yet.
Not at
yet.
That point, no? Just on, because then, if it's already a repeal of the entire bank secrecy law, that's a different matter, a different discussion.
Agreed.
There are all safeguards here in... the Banco Central, as pointed out by the
Ms. Felix.
Ms. Felix. But if we talk about just repealing the bank secrecy law, I'll have questions like, will the proposed Freedom of Information Bill cover government banks so that anybody can inquire into the deposit? So that's a completely different discussion. If we right now, my understanding, if we just limit the matter to the issue of whether or not the Banco Central will be given that authority to have the special examination to look into the accounts of a particular depositor or the accounts in a particular bank, subject, of course, to these safeguards that is presently existing.
Attorney Joven of the Department of Finance is here. May I ask, were you authorized to represent the department insofar as item number one in the agenda is concerned?
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Hello.
So I currently don't have specific authority to represent the Secretary of Finance on this matter, although I brought along all a compilation of all the DOF's previous stand on all the particular provisions of
Can you submit to us in particular the DOF's position on Section 2 of all the Senate bills, I think, on the matter?
Okay.
Thank you, particularly on funding.
Okay.
Kindly submit that within the week. Monday pa naman yan, ba?
Yes.
Within the week, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Governor?
Mr. Chairman, may I suggest that before the DOF submits their position with respect to different amendments, for them to please kindly update their positions, because there's a new leadership in the Department of Finance now.
And baka iba pananaw niya. Kindly note Attorney Jovenhoven.
Hovens, Mr. Chair.
Attorney Hoven, kindly take note of the suggestion of Governor Tango. Senator Guchelen, sir?
Mr. Chair, I just want to go back to the other provisions that PSP is requesting, one of which is increase of supervision in some financial institutions. Mr. Governor, does that include internet banking?
It will include, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator, internet banking. And actually, right now we're in the process of crafting proposed regulation to cover this kind of banking, together with electronic banking and similar activities. This is a very new field, and therefore. Central banks have not really, around the world, have really come up with specific regulations as far as electronic banking is concerned. But there are principles that have been put forward by CPMI. By the CPI, the Committee on Payments and Market Infrastructure of the Bank for International Settlement. So we're trying to align our proposed regulations along those principles that have just been recently issued.
Mr. Governor, I came across one time when I was mayor of Valenzuela, we were trying to push for internet banking, but unfortunately, because of the limitation with transacting to only with government banks, meron pong hindi ho kaya ng government banks to go into settlement. And I came across this financial intermediary, private ho to, no? Na nangongolekta siya at siya, to make it simple, no? Nangongolekta siya nagbabayad po sa local government, no? Dahil nga wala hong technology connectivity between local government and, let's say, land bank. So ngayon pumapasok ho siya dito. Ang risk ho dito, nangongolekta siya. No, at siya yung nagbabayad. I think, if I'm not mistaken, the name of the company is Dragon Pay. No, this is a I think this is a sort of like a clearinghouse for credit cards for banks who are not technologically capable of settling. No, dito sila pumapasok. And I think there are now numerous types of settlement private companies. Ito ba ho ay included ho dito? Are these even legal or are they even regulated? Because they're accepting payments. So if they are, kami hindi namin pinursuho dahil what if tomorrow they shut down, no? San ho kami tatakbo?
Yeah. At this point, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Senator, they're not regulated. In fact, the BSP issued an advisory with respect to Bitcoin, because Bitcoin then was becoming relatively popular, and there were some Bitcoin companies that were being put up. So we issued an advisory saying that these are not registered supervised by the central bank. It's really the lookout of people that transact this particular model or system. Is their lookout to make sure that their investments are safe. So part of the effort that we're doing now is to be able to regulate this type of entities that transact in basically.
Governor, have you heard of this company and this type of operation? Narinig niyo na ba ho yan? Dahil I know hindi lang ho isa eh, no? Parang dalawa o tatlo, I forget the name, but they are operating, yeah. They are collecting money, but the risk is really,
yes,
tremendous to those who are.
We're aware of that, Mr. Senator, Mr. Chairman. And if you want more information, I can ask Deputy Governor Espinilla to provide more information about that.
Deputy Governor Espinilla, you recognize, sir?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, good morning. The BSP is currently has a supervisory authority over banks and other institutions that are specifically named under special law. But what we have observed, Mr. Chairman, is because of the innovations in finance, particularly in payments, and more so for digital payments, there are new players that are coming into the financial system that are gaining a lot of traction. They are not regulated by anyone today. They represent a significant risk not only for AML reasons, but also for consumer protection issues. And the problem that we are facing today is that our banks are properly regulated by the BSP, but in the marketplace, they are competing for financial services against banks. So in a situation where there are entities that are regulated and there are entities that are unregulated, that creates an unlevel playing field that makes it more convenient for those entities to operate, and in the process they tend to grab market share, and the totality of that is it potentially weakens and creates gaps in our financial system. So the proposal of the in our amendments, Mr. Chairman, is to also level the playing field, put them in the proper regulatory environment so that the trust in the payment system will be maintained consistently. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I just want to urge to Central Bank or BSP to look into this type of novelty. It's really, I just came across it, no? But I know for a fact that marami pong mga merchants na nahirapan po mag-transact with, let's say, a bank which is not technologically equipped. Dito sila pumapasok. But the representation really is quite hindi klaro eh. So when we were going through the motion, we just found out that it's too much of a risk, no, to risk the taxpayers' money. That's why we didn't pursue it. But I was just thinking out loud na baka mas marami pa hong pumapasok sa ganito, and maybe swift action is needed because as we speak, no, these guys are going around and transacting. So we don't know, baka one day na lang pumotok ho to, and a lot of people will be affected, no. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Will this be covered, Deputy Governor, by the amendments to the charter of the BSP?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, because the proposal encompasses not just money service businesses, but also payment system operators. So this will fall under this kind of category, Mr. Chairman. I think what the Senator Gatchalian is also describing is a situation where because of gaps in our payment system, these kinds of players are operating to fill those gaps. But today, the BSP is addressing this issue in a more fundamental way by our advocacy to establish a national retail payment system, which basically would try to put in place infrastructure that allow digital payments through the formal financial system that involves banks and other regulated financial institutions, Mr. Chairman. So So this kind of proposal will actually strongly support that initiative that will take us into a more digital finance world, Mr. Chairman, which is where the world is going today. And none of our laws today cover these kinds of players. So this is what the BSP is trying to do, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Gachalian. If there are no other points from Senator Ilon, Chair would like to direct the Committee Secretary to immediately schedule a technical working group after coming up with a matrix and to invite representatives from the BSP. Who will attend, Governor? We need... Sino mapatendin niya? Deputy Governor Gunigunda? Sir? And Deputy Governor Aquino, former AMLAC. May I ask from the BAP if you who will attend the TWG meetings?
Mr. Chairman, it would be myself, my colleague Arnel Almuden, and Connie Hostiniani, the Deputy Director.
Can you take note of their names from the RBAP, sir? Would you be interested in attending?
We will send Attorney Purisima.
Attorney Purisima, you are very welcome. Ms. Felix?
Mr. Yambao and I will participate in the TWG.
Duly noted. We will be scheduling the first TWG meeting. Pakinot na po, September 13, 19, and 26 of September. September 13, 19, and 26.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. I'm from Philippine Deposit Insurance Corporation.
Yes, ma'am. You have more powers than the BSP.
which just took effect last June 11, 2016. We'd like to also be invited in
sure, ma'am.
TWG.
Sure, ma'am. Walang secrecy naman doon. Please, you're welcome to join and attend. Para ma-share niyo yung powers niyo sa kanila. Ano oras? Where? We'll just get the committee room and advise our invitees through the bulletin board at 9 a.m. Thank you. Proceeding now to item number 2 in our agenda, namely the bill of Senators Lacson, Senate President Pimentel, and Senator De Lima. Senate Bill number 47, 115, and 196, respectively. This is on amendments to the bank secrecy law, which we have been touching on in part a while ago. To summarize, Senator Lacson seeks to exempt all public officials and employees, both appointed and elected, from the coverage of the Secrecy of Bank Deposits Act, or RA number 1405. Senator Pimentel, in addition to that, also would like to include other examples where secrecy may not be invoked. Senator De Lima concurs with the position of Senator Lacson, but adds other similar provisions as well as Senator Pimentel. May I know if our guests have seen the three versions through the internet? May I start with BAP? Sir?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry we haven't had the chance to look at the draft bills in internet. But
it's posted on the internet on the Senate website at from our RBAP, sir?
Mr. Chair, wala pa pong comment doon sa mga members namin po. Na-disseminate pa lang po.
Wala pa?
Wala pa.
Pakina lang po?
Yes, sir.
Ms. Felix, ma'am?
In general, Mr. Chairman, we support the proposed measures.
Thank you very much. From Attorney Salido.
Mr. Chair, good morning. With the permission, of course, of the Governor, who is also the Chairman of the Anti-Money Laundering Council, and the Insurance Commissioner, Attorney Duok, the AMLC fully supports the amendments proposed by the honorable members of the Senate.
Insofar as the public officials part is concerned?
That's correct, Mr. Chair.
What about insofar as the others are concerned? Wala na kayong interest doon?
We also fully support also that, Mr. Chair.
Yung version ni Senator Pimentel. For example, the version of Senate President Coco Pimentel. It would include settlement of estates, offer of abatement or compromise for taxpayers' liability, to enforce domestic law pursuant to the country's bilat and multilat agreements. I guess this includes the one with FATF. And in cases of congressional inquiries in aid of legislation.
We support also that, Mr. Chair.
You also support
yes.
that? Thank you. Mr. Governor, would you like to comment on these proposed amendments to the...
Mr. Chairman, we support the relaxation of the bank secrecy law. Laws, 1405 and the two laws on foreign currency deposit accounts, FCDUs. And our support is basically motivated by what we had discussed earlier, that we would want to be able to look into bank accounts to ensure that, in the course of an examination, bank examination, to ensure that there's compliance with regulations, as well as when there is reasonable ground to believe that there's fraud or unlawful activity or irregularity that has been committed or is being committed. So to that extent, we support it, Mr. Chairman. We still have to look at the details of the other bills, the proposals, and we would submit our comments at a later stage, Mr. Chairman.
Hindi rin ako masyadong kumbinsido rin sa congressional inquiry part na yun. Maybe here from the Securities and the Insurance Commission first, Attorney Doc, sir.
Thank you, sir. Your honors.
Good morning, sir.
Yes. As a member of the Anti-Money Laundering Council, I subscribe to the earlier statement issued by the acting OIC of the Executive Secretariat, Attorney Saledo, and then, of course, the statement issued by our chair. No, I support the bills filed by the honorable senators, the exclusion of from the absolute confidentiality of the deposits of the government officials, both appointed and elected, as well as the officers and members of the military and the PNP, and all the officials mentioned in the bill. I likewise endorse the position of the Senate President enumerating the grounds for the exemptions from the confidentiality.
Kami yung may ayaw eh.
Ayaw niyo po yun.
I'd like to raise a question on Commissioner Doc.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Why should a dereliction of duty of the public official authorize the examination or the exemption from the coverage of bank secrecy? Dereliction of duty of public officials. How do you justify this if you're supporting this?
Well, unless there is some monetary consideration involved, I would support that one.
Can you elaborate? The proposed bill says that the bank secrecy will have an exception in cases of dereliction of duty. I would like to see, and maybe I don't see it, but can you elaborate, since you're supporting this bill, what is the connection between dereliction of duty and the authority to examine or to provide an exemption for the bank secrecy deposit? I can appreciate bribery, you know, or cases similar to bribery, but dereliction of duty and cases similar to the dereliction of duty is something that I could not understand. Maybe you can explain it to me since you're in support of this provision.
Please proceed, sir.
Particular provision is already found in Section 2 of the existing Bank Secrecy Act.
No, I'm interested in other cases similar to the dereliction of duty, because this opens the floodgate to all kinds of inquiries. Firstly, what are other cases? And second, what is the connection to this exemption sought?
It's difficult to think of other cases falling outside the existing provision, Your Honor, because dereliction simply means neglect of duty of the public official. And as I have said, unless there is some money consideration involved amounting to bribery.
Has there been cases wherein this was cited as a ground, whether cases similar to or the dereliction of duty itself to justify? Or is this just a dead letter of the law because you cannot apply it?
Mr. Chairman. At this point,
Governor Tango, yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, at this point, the support that's being extended by the AMLAC, I'm now going to wear my AMLAC hat. It's basically the comments are in general terms, and we would like to have the opportunity to discuss the specific provisions that are being proposed, and we will. Subsequently submit our detailed comments on these bills to the committee. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Governor, and any member of the AMLAC, there are two ways of doing it, insofar as government officials are concerned. One way is how Senator Lacson presented it, which is to remove from the coverage of 1405 government officials. The other way is to comply with the provisions of 1405 by requiring all public officials and employees to submit a waiver together with their SALN in favor of the AMLAC, the BIR, the Ombudsman, to look into their deposits. Therefore, you don't have to amend 1405. You simply require all those required to file a SALN to so submit a waiver together with his or her SALN. Hindi pa tayo pumasok sa away at gulong niya, repeal ba natin, wini-weekend ba natin yung 1405? We're in fact complying with 1405. Your thoughts, sir, or the thoughts of anyone? Insofar as that approach is concerned. On government officials lang pa. I presume everyone in front of me, except to my left, are filing a SALN, right? Even the BSP? Everyone, right? I presume. Yes,
Chair,
Attorney
Sabido. Of course, Mr. Chair, with those two proposed amendments, insofar as the anti-money laundering law is concerned, we can already dispense with the conduct of a bank inquiry with those exceptions,
exactly.
Mr. Chair. So the, it will
either
be,
way, it's the same.
It will be faster for us, Mr. Chair, to conduct our investigation.
Well, Mr. Chair, insofar as the BSP is concerned, their ability to conduct special examination would not only cover government officials, it would cover everybody. So it's not made unless there's such a provision in the SALN or even in the amendment to the Anti-Money Laundering Act or this bank secrecy will not, should not prevent us, if we find it meritorious, to allow special examination of bank accounts of everyone, not only of government officials.
In connection with an inquiry and investigation being done by the Banco Central, correct?
Question,
if we so require such a waiver, under our laws, depending on your level, only certain offices will keep a copy of your SALN and therefore the waiver. So, kami sa Senado, I think it's the Senate President, Office of the Senate President that has a copy.
Yes.
And the Ombudsman? Do we give the Ombudsman a copy?
No, I think it's only the head.
So, see, With congressmen, it's with the speaker probably. The copies are in the waivers. With the Banco Central, who keeps your silencer?
For top officials, Office of the President, Mr. Chair.
See, so if the AMLAC would want to gain access to a to an account of a government official, it depends who. So you might have to go to the Office of the President to get a copy because you need a copy. Right? At the very least, a copy. Okay. Or to the Senate President, so on and so forth. So I guess if he will proceed using that avenue, there has to be a single repository of all these salins. Kasi baka mamaya may waiver ka, hindi ka nang makakuha ng kopya.
Mr. Chairman, just reminds me about the rule that the Supreme Court has adopted. I think you're aware of that.
Yeah, they kept their salins to themselves.
And,
no, because I remember during the impeachment of former Chief Justice Corona, we inquired. We asked for a copy of the salin, and the salins of all members of the Supreme Court are with the Office of the Chief Justice.
That's correct, yes.
And the court voted not to release it. So even if there is a waiver, that might be a spoiler. Unless, again, as I said, we require.
So those who want to get exempted from the from that requirement should join the Supreme Court or the judiciary?
There will be 9 vacancies.
Yeah, but seriously speaking, that's an item that we have to look at, Mr. Chair.
If we will proceed with it through that avenue.
Yes.
Unless we simply exempt them from the coverage, in which case the AMLAC, BIR, Ombudsman can very well do it altogether already. Kindly submit to us your formal position paper as AMLAC na kayong lahat, Attorney Salido? As AMLAC na lahat?
Mr. Chair, yes.
So isa ka na lang po? How much time do you need, sir? To include all the proposals, yung mga estate.
About 1 week, Mr. Chairman.
Archive na ito, di ba? Okay, ito isa. Kaya yun ang sabi sa akin pareho, na-approve na ito eh. Eh, itong kay Grace. Ano pa rin? Ano ang sinabi?
Ito siya lang po ang sumabi.
Si Grace. Okay. After a week, so we will also schedule a TWG on this matter, sir. AMLAC as a body already. Would you suggest any other group that we need to invite? Other than, of course, our banking representatives, any other group that we need to invite?
Mr. Chair, can we also invite the Bureau of Internal Revenue in so far as the estate?
Let's invite the BIR. The BIR is not part of AMLAC, no?
No.
Other than the BIR? No, we'll invite you for the TWG of the Amendments to the Secrecy of Bank Deposits Act. Kung mayroong association ng mga retired congressmen at senators, mayors and governors,
Mr. Chair, also the ombudsman, it's possible, insofar as the
relations. The Office of the Ombudsman as well is invited.
Department of
the
Finance.
PDIC as well.
Department of Finance, Mr. Chairman.
Interesado ba kayo dun?
Of course, Mr. Chairman.
Dumadami yung papakainin namin eh. The BIR already has been invited. Anyone else that we need to invite in so far as secrecy is concerned? Sharon, is there an association si Tessie Ang Si? If it's a concern? No, if KFR is a concern.
Pero government lang naman to eh. Okay lang makidnap government.
Does the chairman intend to invite also the private sector other than the banking sector?
Yes, actually, but what association or organization would that be?
Well, the You are talking about the PCCI, the MAP. I'm just finding out from the chairman whether or not there is merit in inviting the private sector other than the banking sector.
I think so. I think so, sir. And I would so like that, it to be more
case,
inclusive.
Yes. So in that case, you might want to invite PCCI, the MAP, the Federation of Filipino-Chinese Chamber of Commerce and Industry, just to hear their views.
The Stock Exchange, Mr. Chairman. Philippine Stock Exchange.
Yeah, Philippine Stock Exchange.
The Stock Exchange as well. So ordered. Point well taken. Before we proceed to other matters, Chair would like to declare a brief recess so that those who have nothing to do with the bills and other matters can already proceed to their normal lives and go back to work. Chair declares a recess. Hearing is suspended. May I request our guests to kindly go back to their respective seats. We will begin shortly. Pahilagi na mga ni. The hearing of the Committee on Banks and Financial Intermediaries hereby resumed. Chair would still like to thank and recognize the presence of Senate President Pro Tem Drilon and Senator Gatchalian. Proceeding now to other matters, namely items 1 and 2 of other matters, the bill of Senator Recto, Senate Bill number 263, and the bill of Senator Poe, Senate Bill number 342. Which seek to amend Republic Act number 3844, and in the case of Senator Recto, provide for a higher requirement on 3844. Bearing in mind, and Chair would like to note and make of record, that last June, the President signed and effectively enacted into law Republic Act number 10878, which also sought to amend RA number 3844 in relation to some of the points raised in these two bills. So at this juncture, may I ask Ms. Borromeo, ma'am, you'll be down to speak, to kindly speak on the proposed measures, namely, again, for the record, Senate Bill number 263 and Senate Bill number 342. Ma'am, you may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning to Senator Gatchalian and Senator Drilon. The proposed provision and the allocation of a maximum of 20% of the bank's total loan portfolio for all non-agri programs and projects will effectively allocate 80% of the total loan portfolio of the bank to agriculture. While the bank has been providing loans to the agricultural sector, it is deemed that there is still a lot of borrowers from the sector which still do not pass the bank's acceptance criteria. As such, the bank has developed special lending programs to farmer borrowers who do not pass the bank's accreditation criteria and lending standards. These programs include the Sikat-Saka program, which we implement jointly with the Department of Agriculture, and the Credit Assistance Program for Program Beneficiaries Development, which we implement in partnership with the Department of Agrarian Reform. Likewise, the Agrarian Production Credit Program.
Ma'am, with your permission, I would just like to acknowledge the presence of Senator Dick Gordon. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Senator Gordon. Moreover, Mr. Chair, as provided under BSP Circular 855, Series of 2014, which is basically the guidelines on sound credit risk management practices, the banks are directed to employ portfolio diversification strategies as part of its credit risk management system, and the land bank adheres to these principles. To comply with this, the bank has diversified its loan portfolio to various industries, with the agricultural sector capturing the biggest share of 17%. Land Bank has also consistently complied with Basel's Pillar 2 and BSP rules and regulations on credit concentration through regular monitoring, risk assessment, and implementation of risk mitigation measures, such that no particular industry has more than 30% loan exposure to total loan portfolio. So we continue to diversify our loan portfolio to various industries, especially those that are in line with the national economic development agenda of the country. If I can proceed, Mr. Chair, to our comments on Senate Bill number 342. Thank you. We would also like to note that some provisions of the proposed bills have similarity with RA number 10878, entitled An Act Strengthening and Institutionalizing Direct Credit Support of the Land Bank of the Philippines to Agrarian Reform Beneficiaries, Small Farmers and Fisher Folk. This became, this lapsed into law on 17 July 2016. The proposed bill, the proposed provision in Senate Bill number 342 that would replace the name of the Land Bank of the Philippines to the Agricultural Bank of the Philippines would entail substantial costs on the part of the bank, Land Bank. The bank needs to spend substantially on media for advertising and other activities to ensure the promotion of the bank's new name for easy recall of its clients and the public as a whole. Recently, the bank has a new tagline, which we help you grow, and we undertook renovation activities to spruce up our branches and ATM networks. And the other provision of this proposed bill and the allocation of 10% of our regular loan portfolio, the proposed creation by the bank of a separate special window for socialized credit to the agrarian reform beneficiaries and small farmers and fishers, which shall be given an allocation of 10% of our total regular loan portfolio is already being addressed under the credit expansion of Land Bank in coordination with the previously mentioned programs that we are implementing jointly with the Department of Agriculture and the Department of Agrarian Reform. These programs are funded and guaranteed by the national government, and these programs cater to farmer borrowers who do not yet squarely pass the lending criteria of the bank. Further, while Land Bank is a government entity created with a social mandate, it is also a banking institution regulated by the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, and as such, the bank strictly adheres to existing credit policies and directives set by the BSP to ensure our financial and operational viability and sustainability. The Land Bank effectively manages our loan portfolio by employing risk-based standards and controls, as well as prudential measures to reduce or mitigate credit risk exposures. And the proposal under the bill that the loans under the socialized credit window shall have an interest rate equivalent to not more than 75% of the bank's prevailing rate to loans to cooperatives, and provided that this conduit shall have an interest rate of not more than 5 percentage points, and the interest spread shall exclude crop insurance premiums and guarantee fees. May we inform the committee, Mr. Chair, that the pricing policy by the bank is risk-based, and which is also in line with the overall credit risk strategy prescribed under BSP Circular Number 855, Series of 2014. And as such, the resulting interest rate is determined basically according to the credit rating of the borrowers. And the proposed socialized rate, which is 75% of the bank's prevailing rate for loans to co-ops, we suggest that as an alternative, that the general pricing of the bank be adopted, but an interest rebate, say 1 to 2% per annum, shall be given to borrowers depending on their repayment performance. With this, we hope to achieve the following. One, to provide an incentive on the borrowers to improve their project management and loan repayment performance. Two, to provide an incentive for them to improve their credit rating so that they will qualify for a lower interest rate. And lastly, to subscribe to the policy of a market-driven rate for rural credit as espoused by the Agricultural Credit Policy Council, or ACPC, an agency attached under the Department of Agriculture. This will also somehow encourage the private commercial banks to lend to agriculture and small farmers and fishers. And lastly, Mr. Chair, we would like to note that RA 10878 did not include foundations with lending authorities and all other means that will be deemed qualified by the bank as qualified borrowers under the specialized social credit facility. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Ma'am, can you submit to us a more detailed explanation as to why 10% will be equivalent to, as you said, how much, 80%?
The 20% cap being proposed by the bill of Senator Recto for non-agricultural related loans.
From what? From the current level of?
What we have now is 17%, Mr. Chair, for agri.
For agri.
The non-agri would be 83 if under the proposed Senate Bill number 263, the non-agri will have to be 20%.
Non-agri is 20?
And the agri would be 80%.
Agri is 80.
That's correct, Mr. Chair.
Hindi lang baliktad.
Sobra pa.
And in the bill of Senator Grace, it's 5% in the existing law, in the existing version of the law that lapsed into law. And it will be, she wants to make it 10%.
Which is complying with this
point. Under Senator Post bill, the share of the agri loans would be 10%.
As against the existing 5%.
That's correct, Mr. Chair.
Existing actual is?
17%, Senator.
So compliant lang naman kayo dun, if ever, di ba?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Deputy Governor Spinilla, they're complying with your regulations on diversification and having a diversified portfolio, but from our point of view, Land Bank has a separate mandate. The same is true, in fact, even with DBP. DBP is supposed to be concentrating on small and medium scale, yet they're lending to the tycoons, almost all of the big names. Almost all of the big names, all borrowed from DBP. I agree that they should have leeway with respect to investing the bank's money so that they will be viable. But what about their mandate? Please, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I think we are presented here with a challenging situation. The two banks that you mentioned, government banks, Land Bank and DBP, they are what is considered to be policy banks. They were policy banks, policy. Mr. Chairman. They were created by the government, owned by the government, to achieve certain policy purposes in the manner that was mentioned by the chair. Yet, at the same time, they are licensed as a universal and commercial bank. And that has certain implications, Mr. Chairman. As a universal and commercial bank, it is also allowed to take money from the public by way of deposits. Like, for example, today, Mr. Chairman, Land Bank's deposit base of about 1.3 trillion pesos as of end March 2016, 30% of that is money from the private sector. The balance is coming from government. So, as a UKB operating as such, it
UKB
has universal and commercial bank. It's a universal bank, Mr. Chairman. So as
UCB.
Such, universal bank. The other one is commercial bank.
So UCB, universal and commercial.
Hindi sabi niya UKB.
Land Bank, Mr. Chairman, is a universal bank. It is bigger or has more authority, more powers than a simple commercial bank, Mr. Chairman.
Sir, UCB, and UKB.
UB.
UB.
Land Bank is a UB. There are other banks that are just KBs. So UBs are bigger
KB
than
meaning?
Commercial bank, Mr. Chairman.
K-Bank Commercial.
Tagalog eh.
Hindi nga. Commercial siguro sa TV. Oo.
Tagalog nga.
So, YKB. I'm curious. YKB if it's a commercial bank? Kasi kayo na yung CB. Yes, Central Bank.
Actually, that's a very probable answer, Mr. Chairman. CB is already the Central Bank. So anyway, what I was pointing out, Mr. Chairman, so being a universal bank with responsibilities to the public, it has to follow prudential rules so that it doesn't get into trouble as well. Because especially for big banks like Land Bank, they can fail. So they have to be prudent as well in their operations. And if they fail, the consequences can also be quite serious for the financial system. But having said that, Mr. Chairman, I think there's a way of reconciling prudent management and the public policy purpose. So they're not necessarily contradictory to one another, except that we have to accept that if certain banks are asked to perform public policy objectives, that exposes them to more risk. And the consequence of that is they may lose some money, hopefully not all the time. And the result of that is periodically they may need additional capital from the government.
So 5% to 10% in the proposal of Senator Grace. They're now at 17. So there's nothing wrong with that.
If I may say, Mr. Chairman, from a universal banking standpoint,
yes,
it is prudent because, as pointed out by the Land Bank representative, it represents a balanced, a more balanced portfolio. Whether that meets social or public policy, that's a different question.
Whether from 17 to 80, am I correct, ma'am?
The proposed
From 17 to 80
bill, Mr. Chair.
Would that fall within your definition of prudent?
Mr. Chairman, I think if Land Bank...
From the UB perspective.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. So as a UB, it will expose, if you shift Land Bank to more concentration to agricultural lending, that will definitely expose them to more risk.
What would be a good ratio in so outside so may agriculture ka? Ano pa ibang
commercial lending to companies,
commercial lending, ano pa iba?
Trade finance is another mga
agriculture and non-agriculture,
yes,
could be a general classification.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
So what would be the biggest percentage that your regulations would allow for insofar as agri or non-agri is concerned, in this case, agri, which would still fall under your definition of prudence?
Actually, Mr. Chairman, our regulations are what we call risk-based. It has nothing to say about what is the optimal mix between agri and non-agri. All that our regulations say today, if your business or your main operations are agriculture, recognize that it has risks. It has, for example, risks to the environment and climate. And accordingly, you have to control that risk by using insurance and other kinds of mechanisms. And if you, as a result of that, you lose more than what you would as a diversified universal bank, then the consequences, from time to time, they may have to go to the government to replenish capital so that they'll be able to continue to perform their public policy purpose.
But agriculture, an agricultural loan covered by crop insurance, would that minimize the risks? But you would require that too.
Yes, Mr. Chair. We require our small farmers and even the large agri-enterprises to get crop insurance, and also to get a credit guarantee cover under the agricultural credit program, the AGFP.
What does that mean?
Well, the crop insurance
what
will...
What is a credit guarantee cover?
The credit cover will pay for the loan in case the farmer borrower cannot pay the loan.
Kanino manggagaling po yun?
Under the AGFP, the Agricultural Guarantee Fund program.
Hindi kaya alam yun.
There is that program, Mr. Chair, under the Department of Agriculture.
Who decides who is covered by that program?
There's a governing board represented by representatives from the Department of Agriculture, Department of Agrarian Reform, the Agricultural Credit Policy, and the Land Bank. So we accredit participating financial
institutions. It's under ACPC, or ACPC is a part of it?
ACPC is a part of it, Mr. Chair.
Is a part of it.
Mr. Chairman, my understanding is that this was basically created by the executive branch, and it was funded from the various revenue agencies, particularly PAGCOR was, I think, some of the money that was...
Edi maliit lang yun.
The fund today is how much, Cecil?
If I may, Mr. Chair, it's about 4.2 billion, but we can leverage it 10 times.
So up to 40 billion?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Up to 42 billion?
Just to be accurate, Mr. Chairman, because one of the features of our regulations today is if a agricultural loan has the agricultural guarantee fund, it has a lower risk weight, and that's important for banks that are availing. The risk weight is lowered to 20%. So to be able to make that hold, the guarantee fund can guarantee up to three times its amount. So it's about.
But if you're covered by that guarantee fund, that means you don't need any collateral anymore.
No. Yes, Mr. Chair, we can lend without collateral.
Without collateral.
Actually, the credit guarantee program under AGFP only guarantees unsecured agri loans.
So it's possible that the loan can be completely unsecured, no collateral, as long as AGFP will guarantee it.
Yes, Mr. Chair, for rice and corn farmers.
And the process is how long? The process of securing a guarantee from AGFP is how long?
Under the program, we accredit financial institutions like other banks and rural banks and thrift banks. And once they have the line, then the loans that they enroll under the guarantee program would be automatically covered.
It's through the lending institution?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
So I guess Land Bank has a quota too?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Under that fund?
Yes, sir.
And you get to decide who it will cover?
We have a policy, Mr. Chair. We cover the sikat-saka borrowers. These are members of irrigators associations, and the loans are clean.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a few points. First, Deputy Governor Espinilla said that the Land Bank and the DBP were formed by law as policy banks. Can you spread into the record what exact policies were supposed to have been pursued with the formation of these two government banks?
Mr. Chairman.
Can you pull it closer to your...
Mr. Chairman, in brief, if we look at the charter of the Land Bank, for example, Land Bank is primarily directed to provide credit to the agricultural sector, to the farmers and cooperatives, Mr. Chairman. And if we look at the charter of the DBP, it's meant to provide lending to industry, Mr. Chairman, to promote the industrialization of our economy. So these were the original purposes of these two banks, Mr. Chairman.
In brief, the Land Bank was supposed to handle the agricultural sector and the DBP, the industrial sector.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Now, what has happened over the years? In other words, has this policy been pursued in the by the two banks? In other words, were their operation geared towards achieving these policies? Or was it lost somewhere in the translation?
Mr. Mr. Chairman, perhaps the question is best answered by the institutions, although from the BSP perspective, we look at the discharge of its mission as a function of its governing body, because they have...
Would it be fair to say that the composition of the loan portfolio would be an instrument to the achievement of these policy goals?
Mr. Chairman, I think the way I look at it, Mr. Chairman, is that the challenge for these institutions in the past has been that they have this public policy responsibilities, but the support, the fiscal support for them, had been limited. So these important policy purposes are being cross-subsidized with their increasingly commercial lending activity. That's what we see, Mr. Chairman, from a regulator standpoint. Now, I don't know how they actually formally state that in their operations.
Yes, maybe Ms. Borromeo can answer that question. The BSP said that basically the Land Bank of the Philippines, by its charter, was supposed to lead in the agricultural development through providing credit assistance and other kinds of assistance to the agricultural sector, as distinguished from DBP, which was tasked to develop our industrial sector. You are now saying, for the record, that the loan portfolio of the DBP Land Bank of the Philippines would principally be 17% for agriculture, 80% for industrial. Is this consistent with the policy mandate of developing, of providing assistance to agricultural sector? Yes.
Through the chair, Senator Drilon. Based on our data, the Land Bank of the Philippines is still the biggest lender in the agricultural sector in the countryside, sir. And while it is true that under our charter, we were basically created to provide timely and adequate financial support in all phases involved in the execution of the needed agrarian reform, we were also authorized under our general powers to grant short-term, and I'm quoting Section 75, number 5 of our charter, we were authorized to grant short-term, medium, and long-term loans and advances against security of real estate and other acceptable assets for the establishment, development, or expansion of agricultural, industrial, home building, or home financing projects and other productive enterprises. But as a matter of operational strategy, Mr. Chair, the bank would support all the priorities of the national government, including infrastructure that would enhance our transportation and power and communication, as well as the establishment of schools and hospitals. Thank you, Mr. Chair, Senator Drilon.
The fact, however, is that 83% of your loan portfolio is on non-agricultural loans.
Yes, Senator.
And you are asserting that even at 17%, you are the biggest lender in so far as the agricultural sector is concerned, and in that sense you are saying that we are fulfilling our mandate.
Yes, Senator.
Is that both in percentage and in real terms you're the biggest?
Real terms, Mr. Chair, our exposure to the agriculture and forestry and fishing sector is 78.19 billion.
So that's the biggest?
We believe so, Mr. Chair.
Percentage-wise, you're the biggest too?
and the percentage share, our percentage share in this
sector? No, percentage ng 17%. In relation to your loanable amount.
No, I think there are smaller banks who have higher exposure as a percentage of their total loans to the agri sector.
And third question, is this the highest ever that the land bank has lent to the agriculture sector, 17%? Mahirap yung 72 billion because nagbabago yung amounts.
Yes. I cannot assume that this would be the highest percentage share of agri-sector in the bank's portfolio, Mr. Chair. We can check on that. But the 78 billion is the highest so far.
Get back to us on that, ma'am. Yes. Senator Gatchalian, with the permission of Senator Gatchalian, Senator Duran, you may proceed.
As a percentage of the total industry loan portfolio, what would be the percentage attributable to the land bank?
We don't have that information right now, Senator. We can
because you claim that this is one of the biggest in the in the agricultural sector. So I was interested in finding out what percentage is that in the total agriculture banking sector. In other words, loans to agricultural sector in the entire banking industry. How much would land bank account for? Can you have that data too?
We can present that to this committee.
I guess, again, I sat in the land bank before and as a ex officio board, and I know for a fact that there is always, the effort to show that we are viable as a bank because of the profits we make is always a factor that competes with the policy of providing loans to agricultural sector because of the risk involved, etc. But anyway, that's a matter that requires, I assume, a longer discussion. But another point, and I don't know who can answer this. Is it true that the loan portfolio, for example, maybe I'll address it first to the land bank. Do you extend loans to the LGUs as against the security of the internal revenue allotments?
Through the chair, Senator Drilon, yes, we do extend loans to the local government units.
And what is it, any significant portion of your loan portfolio?
It's about 45 billion. That's about 10% of our total regular loan portfolio.
So about 10% of your loan portfolio is devoted to loans to the LGUs?
Yes, Senator.
Of course, this is a no-risk, zero-risk loan. Is that correct?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
All right. You're saying again how much in absolute terms?
45 billion.
45 billion. All right. Why did we engage in this kind of a loan activity? Is it because there are no risk involved and therefore madali lang kumita? Bakit hindi natin pinasa ito sa private sector? What is the policy achieved by extending loans versus the internal revenue allotment of the LGU? And why do you compete with the private sector insofar as that is concerned?
The lending program of the land bank to the local government units is in line with our policy direction, Sir Chair, Senator, to support the development agenda of the government, including those of the LGUs. And when the LGU code was enacted in 1991, land bank, I think, it's the first bank who crafted a lending program for the LGUs, knowing that there are safeguards in the law that would protect our investments.
Well, simply, this is a profitable loan portfolio. There are no risks involved because the security is government security, in effect. Right?
Mr. Chair, yeah. Senator, Under the law, there is no mechanism by which the lending bank, including land bank, can have access on the IRA automatically from the DPM because the law prohibits that. So there is also a risk. In fact, some of the LGUs that were adversely affected by typhoons requested for loan restructuring, and we gave them that. But at the very start, we classified the LGUs as those who can borrow and can administer, can handle a loan versus those who cannot afford a loan.
Okay. What is then the how do you call this, bad loans, insofar as those secured by LGUs are concerned?
Well, it's 99% collection
so
rate.
It's 99% collection. It ibig sabihin, talagang walang risk ito, ha? And so, you know, all those explanations. Anyway, so how about, would anyone be able to tell us how much is the LGUs, the DBP loans portfolio, which are devoted to LGUs? Because I do not know that this is consistent with the policy of supporting the industrial sector. Yes?
We don't have data now, Mr. Chairman, but we can certainly provide the...
What is your not up... Do you have data on this?
We have data of the LGU.
It's not available now?
It's just that I don't have it now, Mr. Chairman. We can submit, Mr. Chairman.
Because from the way the discussions are taking place, there appears to be no distinction anymore between the DBP and the land bank. Meron po ba?
Merge na, di ba?
No, that's my next question. Is there really a difference given what is actually happening? Meron ba pagkakaiba ang operations ng DBP at saka noong land bank?
Mr. Chair, Senator, may answer. I think we have very similar undertakings. We have very similar loan portfolio. But what Land Bank has that DBP doesn't have would be the service to the supportive of the agrarian reform program. They are not involved in the agrarian reform program, which Land Bank is very much into.
But is there anything? Well, okay. You're saying that if anything, we should absorb DBP. Yeah, I mean, land bank should absorb DBP. Is that a correct conclusion? Because you're saying you're doing everything similar, except insofar as your role in the agrarian reform program, which DBP does not have. But, you know, from the way you describe your operations, that's not a very significant portion anyway. So are you saying, therefore, that we should absorb, the land bank should absorb DBP?
You can invoke your right to remain silent, then.
Or would you rather put it on record? Anyway, let's leave that at this point. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Frank. Senator Surin, you're recognized,
Chair,
sir. You may proceed.
Again, I have some elementary question. Ms. Borromeo, yung 14% of your agri, is it loaned directly to the farmers or through the thrift banks and rural banks?
Through the chair, Senator Gatchalian. Our loan to the agri, forestry, and fisheries sector, which captures 70% of our portfolio, is given in various forms. We have loans directly to small farmers and fishers.
Direct ho yun.
Meron ho kaming direct, meron kaming through conduits, through their cooperatives and other organizations, through our partnership with the rural banks and some thrift banks and microfinance institutions, and also to large and medium and large agri players.
What type of loans are these? Anong klaseng mga loans ho ito?
Various types. We give
product. Ano po yung pinaka top three?
Top three would be steel, palay and corn, and agribusiness, the processing of agri products. And we also have a large exposure to banana and oil palm.
When you say palay and corn, humihiram sila to buy inputs. Ganun ba ho yun?
That's correct, Apo. Senator.
Do you have any idea right now, ho, if you have any information as to sa isang taon, ilan po ang nag-a-apply at ilan po ang pumapasa?
Yung nag-a-apply, we don't have that information now, but we can get that. But
in your estimates po?
We have been releasing loans to about 350,000 farmers.
So
every year,
so
every cropping season.
In terms of percentage, how many of those, obviously the ones who passed is 17%, no? But I just want to understand, ilan po yung hindi ho pumapasa, no? Ilan po yung nag-apply at hindi ho sila pumapasa in real terms, no? In absolute numbers.
We don't have that information now, Senator. We can.
Pero is it marami, I'm sure, is it more than 50% na nag-a-apply hindi ho pumapasa? Is that an estimate? Is that a safe estimate?
The number of those who apply and cannot be given loans are small relative to what we approve, because we do a proactive marketing. Based on our acceptance criteria, we go and visit the cooperatives that we definitely know who can pass our criteria. So we have.
But how many of those pass and do not pass? I mean, for example, lang the cooperatives. I just want to get a good view on how many borrowers or potential borrowers do pass and how many do not pass.
As far as farmer cooperatives are concerned, they do not actually, not a lot of them actually come to us and get a loan, especially those weaker ones, because they know the standards of the bank. So it's more proactive on the part of the bank to go after those stronger co-ops that we know pass our lending criteria.
Doon po sa direct, yung direct na humihiram
mo sa inyo. On the direct, we do that under the Sikat Saka program and APCP, or Agrarian Production Credit Program, with the DA and the DAR. So again, it's proactive because we.
But how many po ang pumapasa at hindi pumapasa in that particular program?
Doon ho kasi sa kung pumapasa, it all depends on the certification of the Irrigators Association. Mm. If they certify their members to be of good standing, then we lend to them.
So that's the only requirement.
Yes.
That's the only requirement. But do you have any estimates po? How many
Of their members do not
How many
apply?
Of the members comply and pass your requirement?
I don't have that information right now, Senator, but we can.
But is it more than 50%? More than 50% of those who go to land bank do actually get some form of loan? Mayroon bang ganun, 50%?
Yun nga ho, Senator. Those who do not qualify do not even get to the point of going to the bank to request for a loan, because at the level of the association, they already screen their members who do not pass the,
I just, criteria. My point, Ms. Borromeo, is to understand the requirements and kung ano po yung nagiging problem kung bakit hindi ho sila pumapasa. No? Maybe it's also that 17% portfolio is also a function of stringent rules, or maybe the market cannot absorb, no? The agri market cannot absorb more of that loan, no? The absorption of the market is also relevant, eh. Can the market really absorb, no? If you look at itong statistics, 10% of our GDP comes from agri. That's about a trillion pesos, no? You're only lending about 78, so medyo malayo. If you look at, very simple terms lang, no? But what my concern is, can the market still absorb more loans? Baka wala ho tayo, baka yung mga farmers themselves cannot absorb, o hindi rin nila alam paano gawin, or wala silang capability. So, We have to look at those angles. I don't know if you have those type of study.
Yes, Ms. Senator. Actually, during our discussions with the DA and the DAR, the absorptive capacity of the farmers and their organizations is also an issue.
Yes,
because
that's
as you rightfully mentioned, not all of them are ready to get formal credit because their management team is not yet matured. They don't have bookkeeping records, which is very important when
you
access
credit. That's why if we reverse the trend and make it 80% agri, can the market absorb 80%? Meron ba silang capability to do that? Do they have the borrower mentality and discipline to actually repay? No? I don't know nga. That's why I'm asking.
Those are very valid concerns, Senator. And actually, the answer
natin, babagsak naman sila, wala rin kayong ginagawa. Ano?
And probably for most of the small farmers, credit is not the right intervention yet.
That's why.
Because they have to have.
But do you have
maturity?
That study to educate us whether the absorptive capacity of the farmers is already there to help them or to assist them? Meron bang ganun, no?
The bank doesn't conduct that study on its own, but we rely heavily on the research of the Agricultural Credit Policy Council.
Which is under the DA.
The DA.
Which is under the DA. Mr. Chair, I think to pursue this discussion, Mr. Chair, I think it's also important to invite the Department of Agriculture, no? Just to shed light on the absorptive capacity of the agri industry itself. No? I mean, pwede natin taasan, pwede 100% of the loan portfolio of land bank lend to agri, pero kaya ba ng agri? Yun ang dapat maintindihan ho natin.
Chair directs the COMSEC to kindly invite the Department of Agriculture, representatives from ACPC, Sampaman. But ACPC is only a part of AGFP. And then?
The head of ACPC is a member of the governing board of the AGFP.
Who's the head of AGFP?
One of the undersecretaries of the Department of Agriculture.
So AGFP, the representatives from AGFP and ACPC. Who else? And also inform the authors of the measure so that they can also be perhaps here to engage our invited guests with respect to their proposal. Who else, ma'am, that you would suggest? May naisipa po kayo?
As far as the agrarian reform beneficiaries are concerned, maybe we should also invite the representatives from the Department of Agrarian.
Let's get the DAR representative as well. COMSEC is directed to invite representatives from the DAR. Any other points you would like to raise? Yes, Ms. Felix.
For the record, the CTB and I guess ARBAP, who will also speak after me, we affirm our support for the bill of Senator Recto proposing that the lending of land bank to non-agri be increased to 80%, no? Because then this will solve the problem of the private banks ever since, wherein land bank and DBP have been competing with the private banks. I guess it's pretty obvious. This is the reason behind that, I guess. We believe that land bank should, their mandate should be foremost and primordial as far as their, since it's supposed to be a policy bank. Statistics also on the bank's compliance with the Agri-Agra law will show that not even if land bank is saying that they're the biggest lender for agri and this is their mandate, how come even the commercial banking sector and even the thrift banking sector for that matter, we are falling below, no, our required 15% compliance for agri. For that matter, only our bank has more than complied with it at 33%. So to us, it's very important because this This then shows the real picture as it is now in the banking industry, and this has been our concern for so many years already. Thank you.
Mr. Pasha, sir, you recognize?
Yung kasi hong ang exposure ho ng rural bank industry sa buong financial industry is 1.7 na lang ho, percent. And yet, kami ho ang nasa pinakababa na nakaka-deliver sa countryside. So kung mas masusuportahan ho na mabibigyan kami na hindi naman namin kalaban ng mga government banks, sa tingin ho namin, mas magiging profitable ang mga rural banks.
Mabibigyan po kayo ng ano?
Ng opportunity ho na hindi naman namin kalaban, kakompetensya ang land bank po.
Question, sir. When you say kompetensya, it means...
May mga produkto ho kami na nagkakapare-pareho ho.
No, but it means nga po, mas mataas kayo kaysa sa kanila?
Mas mataas ho ang nakakapagpautang kami sa mga farmers kasi ho mas malapad ang aming coverage sa countryside po.
But interest rate wise, you're higher or lower?
Mas mataas ho. No? Mas, sa tingin ko, mas mataas ho tayo ng konti.
Mas mataas
ngayon? Yes.
Because
mas
of the infrastructure, the intermediation po.
Opo. Pero kami ho ang nakaka-deliver sa baba.
I don't get it. So you support the increase to 80%?
Yes, para ho naman. Sa tingin ho namin, mas gaganda ho ang pagkakataon ng mga farmers natin kung lalakihan ho ng land bank ang exposure nila sa agrikultura po.
Which includes lending to rural banks. Is that the point you're driving at?
No, I think because they're competing with your other product.
Nagko-compete nga ho yung iba naming produkto.
If we will increase their exposure to agriculture to 80%, then all the more that they will compete with you.
But there are other products.
May ibang
which they are into also.
Oho.
That
kinokompitan kayo sa commercial.
But that is part of their existing 80%. The commercial feature, I guess.
Commercial?
Yeah.
So ayaw nyo sila mag-compete sa commercial sa inyo, sa baba? Is that it?
Sa ibang produkto po.
Commercial?
Opo. Mr. Chair, Mr. Pasha, ika-clarify ko kanina, nasabi po ni Ma'am Borromeo na they also go through you in some of the loans.
Yung iba ho. Yung iba, iba po. Hindi naman ho lahat po.
This
hindi
is through a loan window type of operation.
Yes.
No, a loan window type of operation po. Yung po yung gusto nyong malakihan pa?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Hindi ho yung exposure ho nila sa agri, kung mas maganda ho, kung mas papalakihan nila.
But how do you take advantage of that? Eh kung diretso naman sila sa farmers. So why is it good for you?
yung kanilang exposure ho sa agri?
Oho.
Eh sa tingin ho namin mas lalaki ang mga ang perang iikot sa countryside.
Not as an additional
hindi ho sa amin,
product for you or...
Hindi ho sa amin ang ano. Ang nakaka-affecto ho sa amin din, kamukha nung ibang mga produkto ho na commercial na nakakain din ho ng land bank. Na kumari naman ho, yung mga rural banks din naman ho ang makapagpautang na noon.
Thank you very much, sir. I would like to acknowledge the presence of Senator Zubiri. Yes, to wind up, Mr. Vertuso.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Senator Zubiri, good morning, sir, and the honorable senators. We at the Bankers Association welcome this discourse on agricultural and agrarian reform lending, because we believe we have a bigger issue here, much, much bigger issue, a much more important issue. It's called Republic Act 10,000. This is basically the law that mandates all banks to allocate up to 20% of their net loanable funds to these two sectors.
This what law is this?
Republic Act 10,000.
Agri-agra? Ang laking butas naman ang nilagay dyan eh.
Anong nilagay natin? No, I said 25% of of net loanable funds. That's 15% to agriculture and 10% to agra. But there is a little colatilia there. The excess in agra could be put into agri, but the other way around doesn't work. Unfortunately, the absorptive capacity of the agra is, as we all understand, much lower. This law was passed in the mid-70s. We believe the portion of agriculture as out of the GDP was much, much higher at the time. I think Senator Gatchalian had indicated earlier that now it's around 10%. So this is really, we welcome the opportunity to present to this August body a position paper to, if not repeal, amend this agri-agra law.
Sir, but correct me if I'm wrong. Agri-agra allows the banks to buy or invest in government securities to comply.
Not necessarily, sir.
With the provisions
that
of this
law. That was the original
law.
Yeah, in 2009, they passed an amendment. They restricted the compliance. Before, they could buy land bank or...
So, ngayon, wala na.
Wala na po.
Isa ako sa mga bumoto dun eh.
Okay, isa po. Just to... the latest figure suggests that the compliance of the banks is about 13%. 30% on agriculture alone and 1% on agra. So that means all the banks are under penalty, they're penalized, and we pay, the penalties used to go to the Banco Central, but now they only get 10% of it. And
I'll schedule another meeting and call DEA and agrarian reform. You know, I think all of us should work together so that we can come up with actually a viable program that's workable for the banking industry, that's compliant with the regulations of BSP, and at the same time, policy-wise, we would be able to direct money in the sector that needs it the most, which is agriculture. Yes, sir, please. Mike, please.
We check the world. And we're practically the only country that's doing it this way. Mandated lending, mandated by law. The very few countries which have something similar are mandated not by law, like certain institutions are specified. Maybe like the land bank or the DBP would be mandated to perform this function, not the commercial banks. And if I may add, private banks' capital are private capital. So this is a form of taxation as well. But we're getting into something more. So thank you for the opportunity to presenting this.
We will try to identify a program, sir, that will be mutually beneficial. Not mutually beneficial, but beneficial to all, actually. Because if only we can prove that it works, perhaps even with our law, yourselves will come into it and invest in it as well. Hopefully, in the not so far future. We will schedule these two bills for another hearing, hopefully, with those additional invited guests to attend. And also the authors to share with us what they have in mind. Senator Zubiri, you are recognized, sir. You may proceed.
Thank you. I'm actually filing today also amendments to the Bank Secrecy Law. So on the next hearing on the Bank Secrecy Law, I'll be able to tackle also my version of the bill. And I just like to put on record as well, because I'd like to make special mention on Land Bank. I've been working with Land Bank when I was in the Senate in the 16th Congress? 15th Congress. As chairman of the Cooperatives Committee, I was also chairman of the Gawad PITAC. I know for a fact that Land Bank has been working side by side with several cooperatives, and we congratulate them on that. And as a matter of fact, all their awardees are part of the Gawad PITAC program. So at least I'd like to state that for the record. And back as chairman of the Cooperatives Committee, I'm excited to work again with Land Bank. And in fairness to them, they've been focusing really on the agri sector and the rural sector. As a matter of fact, they have a new campaign. That's their motto, is that we help you grow campaign. So on the record, I'd just like to put that, Mr. Chairman, because in fairness to them, I know everybody here in the Senate and in the House, sometimes when there are farmer groups that come to us and complain to us, we make our favorite whipping boy the land bank. But as a matter of fact, they're probably the only institution that these people go to, at least in the majority of the banks in or the farmers in the countryside. So I'd like to also commend them for their efforts. Mr. Chair, thank you.
Duly noted. Thank you, Senator Zabini. I'd like to thank and use this opportunity to thank everyone for attending this morning's hearing and for being on time. Maraming salamat po. Si DJ Espini Lilangan na huli ng konti kanina. Maraming salamat po sa oras ninyo ngayong umaga at sa pagdalo. Sa muli, magandang umaga. Hearing is suspended.